Yeah, good afternoon, everybody. Trying to wake you all up. As Mr. Bansal said, the start always difficult. Just after lunch, nice lunch with still the smell was coming a little before. Okay, so what I thought was that instead of talking about too many things, because then nothing registers and people think, what did he talk about? I'll just focus on one particular topic, that in today's industry where we are all talking about operational excellence, trying to ensure that the productivity is at the highest. And then this overall wave of digitalization coming in, and how the both things can get dovetailed, because ultimately we are all from business, we look at business metrics, these things are just enablers. How using increased productivity we can ultimately drive the top line or the bottom line of the company. And the area which I'll focus is more on the uptime, but as you know, just by running faster can sometimes be foolish, but when you are trying to increase the uptime, the safety part cannot be compromised because of the nature of the industry in which the oil and gas operates. Safety, of course, comes first. Uptime is definitely an important area, but safety cannot be compromised. So I'll try to balance between both and try to share some examples how globally the industry is trying to solve this problem, and how digitalization is acting or accelerating this thing. Okay. Now, when we look at maintenance has been, of course, not a new subject for all of you. And we have this kind of preventive maintenance, reliability-centric maintenance. A lot of these topics have been around for a long time, right? There is a industry analyst, ARC. They did a survey in the process industries and, of course, a lot of adjacent industries. And what was realized that whatever the wear and tear happens in the equipment is not just the mechanical part. It's basically, it was process induced. So the problem which we always try to solve by doing preventive maintenance, that fine, we are able to address the equipment wear and tear periodically and make sure that the equipments are running. But many times there are surprises. And these surprises are not because of design issues. These surprises are because this equipment is not in isolation. It's like how you are sitting in this hall. You are not sitting in isolation, right? You are sitting among the various people. Similarly, the equipment in a plant or asset is sitting in context of a process. It could be a hydrocracker unit in a refinery, or it could be a upstream offshore platform, right? So this is the problem what we are trying to solve, that how to detect the process-induced failures much in advance so that you are able to avoid the actual failure, right? The early detection is what is being spoken about. Now, the asset optimization is, of course, the theme of this event. A lot of speakers spoke about asset optimization in the first half. And the good part is now everybody is thinking about the life cycle. So when the asset gets engineered, the asset then gets operated, and how to dovetail the maintenance aspects into it to make sure that at an overall level we are able to optimize it from its performance point of view, from its safety point of view, from the cost of both in terms of cost of installation and also cost of operation. Okay, so that is what in nutshell the asset optimization we are trying to look to. Now, it's not that attempts have not been made in past to solve these kind of problems. Technology has been there for many years. There has been repeated attempts in solving these problems, but they have not been very effective. Because when you have an operating equipment in a plant, what you try to do is create a twin out of it, right? So people were talking about digital twin and all those things. Now, when you're trying to create a twin, you need, it's not only how it was designed, because this asset or the equipment has been running for, let's say, 5 years, 10 years. So it has undergone certain changes. So you need to calibrate with what is the actual operating condition of this particular equipment. And that is where the classic approach of what is used in process industry of modeling is not very effective for when it comes into the maintenance subject. What we need to do is, in fact, the process industry has been very much leader, because I have also interacted with the discrete manufacturing. As compared to discrete manufacturing, process industry has taken leadership on technology adoption of implementing tools like Historian and all that, where you are able to capture data in real time. So that is good part about it, that we have information getting captured, data getting captured. But how do I take the intelligence out of it to make sure that I'm able to be more predictive and more prescriptive in my operations? Okay? And that is where the modeling of the equipments and trying to calibrate them is a very time-consuming approach, and that has not been very provided very effective. And a lot of false alarms in terms of when actually the equipments are going to fail. And industry doesn't like false alarms, then the whole confidence goes down, right? Okay, so what are we trying to solve is that by using this whole thing about the predictive and prescriptive, you are basically trying to answer three W's. When is it going to fail, why, and what. So what is the prescriptive part, the when and the why is the predictive part, right? Okay. I'll move forward with the illustrative example. Now, as I said, when you look at any specific unit in a refinery or a chemical plant, or it can be in the upstream, it is broken down into static and rotating equipments. Now, in this case, let's take example of this rotating equipment. That is getting fed by certain input which is coming from a static equipment which is in the upstream. And of course, there are different sensors like temperature, pressure, all those things which are measuring. And there could be vibration and all those things which are getting measured on a continuous basis. So what we are trying to do is, by taking all the data which is on the equipment and which is on the upstream and the downstream, you are trying to basically solve the problem that how I can see if there are any process upsets in terms of certain, let's say, a gas is being fed and certain solid particles or liquid may come into the gas. That can cause certain degradation in the equipment. So if I'm able to solve this kind of problem of doing a process-induced failure and detect this process disturbances early in the cycle, I'm able to address it much, much smarter way, right? And then I also know that why this problem is happening and what to do to solve this problem. And that is like going to a doctor and he's prescribing you certain medicines. And you hope that these medicines will solve your problem, right? So that is what is prescriptive. So let me show an example. I think that will become more illustrative than talking with a lot of words.
In 2015, a major oil and gas company was asked to test MTEL Previse software. MTEL examined 5 separate assets within 2 classes. This included charge pumps and multi-stage reciprocating compressors. Each pump had 50 sensors. Each compressor had 160 sensors. Altogether, MTEL imported 220 million sensor values. MTEL Previse resolved 35 sensor quality issues, discovered 62 breakdowns, and classified 31 problem codes, allowing MTEL to determine the top 10 failures. From all the data gathered, MTEL Previse created 80 failure agents. Agents relentlessly look for issues that lead to equipment failure 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, forever. Let's take a look at the results of one compressor test. Sensor data gathered from the compressor provided a complete picture of degradation and failure. The data was extracted from sensors on the machine itself, the process parameters around the machine, and the upstream process. The customer held back data to see if MTEL Previse could categorize a failure, then detect a repeat event. It did so with great success. MTEL Previse accurately predicted a breakdown 38 days in advance, and on a second occasion, 49 days in advance. MTEL agents are rewriting the PF curve, providing insight into failure well before degradation can create serious equipment damage or cause critical failures. The assigned failure agent detected a degradation signature where upstream low-purity hydrogen contamination was the primary contributor. Now, a network of smart agents in your machines can universally communicate all known conditions for improved equipment protection globally.
Okay, so in fact, MTEL is machine telling. Somebody was mentioning in the morning that you should be able to listen to the equipment. So it's basically equivalent of that, right? Okay, so I'll not get into a lot of nitty-gritty or technicalities. As I said, the whole thing is to leave you with a concept. This is basically using what we were talking about in the morning is all the power of artificial intelligence and machine learning. So what you're trying to fundamentally do it, if I speak in a layman language, trying to learn from the previous experience and become smart in terms of predicting the future and also prescribing how to solve it. So, and one of the speakers was also talking about there is, of course, a lot of experienced people are retiring, a lot of knowledge is going away. So it basically is trying to solve multiple problems. And then when you are trying to do early prediction, you are also attacking the safety aspect because you can avoid any catastrophic failure of the equipment, certain shafts breaking down, certain bearing breaking down, and that can result into or certain gas leak or something like that. So you are getting the early prediction of failure. You can organize spare parts. You can become more smarter in terms of weather and also in terms of safety, right? Now let me, since there are a few minutes left, I will just talk about from the examples perspective. Now it's not that these things, these are just concepts. These are actually happening in the industry globally. One example is the Saras, it's a Mediterranean refinery based in Italy. So this is, again, they had a large digitalization program and they wanted to increase their plant uptime by 1 to 10 days, reduce their operating expense by almost 1 to 5%. And when you look at the refinery scale, these, when you translate them into dollars or rupees, this becomes very significant. Now, this is an example of a hydrocracker in Saras refinery. So where using the predictive and prescriptive, using the historical data, and using the power of machine learning, how can you predict the future failure? So basically build the agents, which can be done very quickly because there is no modeling involved in this. You are just trying to create the failure agents based on past data, when those failures happen, and then you look at the upstream process data and the equipment data, and then being able to predict the specific events which can happen in future. So in this case, the wall height, high outlet temperature, 39 days, wall replacement due to instrumentation failure, 25 days. So just imagine the operations and maintenance teams are getting that bigger runway in terms of making their operations more predictive, and they are not having any surprises in their operations. Similar examples on ESPs on the upstream, each of these failures were causing almost $1 million. Because of confidentiality, we have withheld the name of the customer, but we can talk this as an example. And this was a similar thing, how using the operational data, I can predict these ESP failures much in advance, right? Now this is an example of LDP in a petrochemical customer. This is in Europe, in Borealis. A similar methodology was used. And in this case, they also wanted to do transfer learning. Because when you have similar equipments, again, the whole thing is about smartness, right? If I have learned about a failure on one equipment, why I need to wait for the same failure to happen on similar class of equipment and then learn from it? Why don't I do transfer learning? So one compressor, I learned from it and then apply it to all the similar compressors across the petrochemical complex, right? And that is where they were able to get benefited. And again, when you look at hypercompressors, again, from safety perspective, it's very important the kind of pressures they operate in, and the criticality of this equipment in the petrochemical point of view. Again, for different areas, they were able to detect these kind of failures much in advance, month, not only just a month, sometimes even 2 months in advance, right? Okay, so this is what I wanted to leave you with. So the technologies are becoming more predictive and prescriptive, and this is the time to leverage these and make sure that you are able to run your operations more safer and more predictive in nature, right? Thank you very much.